machines on the MotoGP grid. Yamaha stick with the inline four and will be the only two bikes as they were last year with that configuration of engine, but does look as though they've made a positive step, as have Honda as well. We'll speak about that in more detail with Jack Gost in just a second when we cross live to the Sepang International Circuit. But before that, I promised you that we'd take a look at the teaser for There Can Be Only One Season 2. As I said, available now on MotoGP.com, and we'll be able to view completely for free on YouTube this coming Sunday. And this is what you can expect.
These guys are not better than me.
I am the best.
We are lost.
We are not friends anymore.
Mi girano I coglioni.
Solo puede quedar uno 2023.
22 of the world's best and fastest riders. All with one big goal: to take the number one from reigning world champion, Pecco Bagnaia.
My dream is to continue winning title for many years.
He has the best bike.
The main rival is the number one.
He has the number one. I would like to be one of the greatest of the history.
20 rounds, 40 races, and a new thrilling era with the arrival of the Tiso Sprints.
Oh, contact! Miguel is a
fucking
down!
Marco Bezzecchi
is a MotoGP
winner.
You can break a control.
I was not enjoying my life.
The riders have a big ego.
Possiamo mettere ancora nervoso al socio.
Need to be more focused on his job.
This championship is very long, so wait.
What a way to bounce back!
A me non mi intimida.
If I'm not safe in first row, where I have to start?
Deve anche dar dentro per molto.
You never know what can happen.
Sta regalando punti a tutti. Via, prendeteli tutti.
Can you believe it? There is another massive plot twist!
There we go. If that hasn't whet the appetite and wants to make you sit down, of course, after the show is finished and watch all five episodes, then make sure you do. Absolutely brilliant, detailing the full story of the 2023 MotoGP season as we followed all of the key championship contenders. As I said, available now on MotoGP.com and will be available on YouTube this coming Sunday. Right, we'll be heading across to Sepang very soon indeed. Before we do, though, the start of the new season just around the corner. Perfect time to remind you that head to MotoGP store to make sure that you're fully kitted out for the season opener in Qatar. Of course, today is all about the Monster Energy Yamaha squad, and you can see there's plenty opportunity to make sure that you're looking resplendent in blue by the time Qatar rolls around. Right, let's chat away then to my good friend and colleague Jack Gost, who's made the trip out to Malaysia to bring you all of the happenings there over the Sepang test. He'll be live with Simon Crafar for After the Flag. But Jack, let's talk the Sepang shakedown, shall we? You were there on the ground. There's plenty of storylines for you to take us through. First, Yamaha on track, and as I said, looking to be taking a step in the right direction. Honda, a lot of positive vibes coming from there as well. And of course, Pedro Acosta dazzling everybody. Just run us through all of the key storylines from the Sepang shakedown.
Yeah, it certainly was a shakedown that had a lot of storylines, as you do say, Jack. Good time to come to us, as courteously the Aprilia has just shut off behind me, which is very nice of them indeed. But of course, we'll start with Yamaha, because Yamaha are the main topic of this presentation live here. They're still kind of the biggest mystery in terms of the information that we know about them. We didn't really hear too much of them. The riders didn't speak after the shakedown test at all. What we did see into the timesheets and also the top speed trap is that Fabio was pretty quick through those top speed traps. So whether that's the engine or they made progress with their electronic setup to get some more rear grip and better drive out the corner. But anyway, better top speed with Yamaha has always been the name of the game in recent seasons. We've seen that Fabio has been pushing for that a lot, and mainly because he also wants to run bigger aero, which was another thing that we saw. Test rider Cal Crutchlow was certainly busy testing different aero setups. One particular one that he seems to be mainly focusing on, with the big wings out the front, kind of like a mustache, kind of like the Aprilia, actually, just over there behind my right shoulder. So there's definitely good feelings, at least, with Yamaha. There's some positive indicators. There's also some change that we haven't seen in a long, long time. They updated the tail unit, which I think is the first time in three or four seasons, but also the whole seat unit is updated too, which I'm told is the first time in quite a while that actually they've done a full remodel in that area of the bike. So whether they've gone for the Ducati route with a mass damper in the tail, as Joan Zarco rides past on the Honda, we'll see anyway. But good segue onto Honda, actually, because Zarco, particularly in his debrief with the media, extremely positive about what he's seen at Honda, actually saying that between the 23 bike and the Valencia test bike that he rode, 7/10 improvement, he reckons, at least 7/10, he actually said. So a massive, massive jump from Honda, if that is the case. We will see, obviously, throughout these next 3 days, then also going on to the Qatar test and, of course, more importantly, the Qatar GP. I mean, it's also backed up with Luca Marini, who's been positive about the Honda since jumping onto it. He says that the project is in not such a bad place and there's real optimism there. John Mir is the same, although Mir seems to be perhaps a little bit more conflicted as to which kind of setup in terms of engine specification that he prefers. Yeah, we do know that they have a couple of different engine specifications, and Taka Nakagami was very, very complimentary of one that he said was much easier to ride and made the bike faster as well. Of course, Pedro Acosta was the biggest headline, the shakedown test, and it goes with all the pundits for that, because that 58.1 lap time was only about 6.5, 7/10 off the outright lap record round here, a pole position from 2022 or 23, I can't remember which year now. But a massive lap time, incredible statement lap, and we had our colleague Emilio Vasquez actually ask Augusto Fernandez, Pedro's teammate, earlier on what he thought of it, and he just said, impressive. We knew he was going to be fast, but yeah, that was very, very fast indeed. We'll have a quick wander over towards the Yamaha, because they do actually have the garages open for now. But certainly on Pedro's front, I mean, watch out for him. As you said, Jack, he's got 10 races to beat that record for Marc Marquez, with the youngest ever winner in the MotoGP class, and you really wouldn't bet against him. Back to you, Jack.
Thank you very much, mate. Looking well. Make sure you stay dry, stay as less sweaty as possible in Malaysia. Look as though those grey clouds were looming just behind you. What a lovely shirt that was as well. I wonder if he's been down to Kuala Lumpur and got a nice little silk number. He's looking fine, is Jack Gorse, as he will do throughout the Sepang test as well, as I said, both him and Simon Crafar on site there to be able to bring you all of the analysis over the next 3 days of running. Right, it is, of course, time to focus our attention now on the Monster Energy Yamaha squad. As ever, you guys can get in touch with us in the chat. Make sure you put your comments in, what you think that both Alex Rins and Fabio Quartararo are able to do this year, and we'll kick things off with a poll. So you guys just need to put in the chat A or B. I think this will be a very, very fascinating inter-team battle. Who will finish higher in the 2024 MotoGP World Championship? Will it be Fabio Quartararo, of course, the 2021 World Champion, or will it be Alex Rins, who is aiming this year to become the first MotoGP rider ever to win with three different manufacturers? Interesting one, that. What do you think? Will it be Fabio? Will it be Alex? Let us know in the comments. Of course, after the flag is going to be absolutely key to our Sepang test coverage. 3 days, 5:30 local time in Malaysia through to 7 o'clock. Bringing you the best analysis, live, exclusive, on-site reaction as well from the riders and key team personnel as well. And it will be expertly anchored by this man, Lewis Sudderby, who joins us now just to have a very quick chat ahead of us swapping across to Malaysia to, I believe it's actually Simon Crafar that's going to be doing the launch today. And I've seen a little snippet of the show as well, and he's done an excellent job. Good old Simon, nice to see that they're keeping him busy out there. Lewis, how are you? Good to see you.
Very well.
Before we touch on after the flag, Yamaha presentation coming up. We just heard from Jack there. Looks as though they are taking steps in the right direction. A big year ahead of them. And I think if you're looking at sort of inter-team battles and the strength of teams out there, you're going to have to search very hard to find a team with less might and less power than Fabio Quartararo and Alex Rins. They are two of the very best in MotoGP.
Yeah, pound for pound, you could argue that Yamaha have the strongest rider lineup on the grid. Alex Rins up there with the most naturally talented riders on the grid. He's won for Honda, and of course he won for Suzuki. We all know what Fabio Quartararo can do. He's a proven world champion. For Yamaha this year, they've got to try and reverse a worrying trend over the last couple of years. They've been in steady decline for the last couple of years relative to their competition from Fabio Quartararo's 2021 title win. From the point that he was 91 points clear in 2022, he hasn't led a MotoGP racing lap since. And Yamaha, of course, haven't won since. They went winless for the first time in 20 years last year. And of course, that's a trend that they'll be looking to reverse. There are a number of factors why that could change this year. And of course, you've already alluded to their running at the shakedown, which is one of the concessions available to them. It is important that Yamaha use those concessions to their benefit to try and close the gap to Ducati.
Yeah, absolutely. As we said, both Rins and Quartararo definitely got the ability to be competing up at the sharp end. You do feel it's about the motorcycle that they can bring for them. I guess as part of the concessions, it's going to be the job of Lynn Jarvis, Mayo Merigali, to let the riders know that Rome wasn't built in a day. This isn't going to be an overnight success. It may well take some hard work. It may well take some difficult days. But as long as they buy into the project, you feel as though they can definitely grow from this baseline, shall we say, after the disappointment of last year. Just before that, though, let's have a look at the poll results. No, we won't. Will we? Won't we? In fact, whilst we
I'm expecting it to be pretty close, to be honest. Because as you say, Fabio Quartararo and Alex Rins are evenly matched. Wasn't close at all, as it turns out.
Really? I can't believe that. Surely.
Where are the Fabio Quartararo fans?
I know. Surely there's somebody out there that thinks that Fabio Quartararo will beat Alex Rins in the World Championship this year. In fact, I'll put my hand up. I'm one of them, so we can change that. 99% to 1%. I fancy Fabio to beat Alex in the inter-team battle this year. Questions over Alex's fitness. Yes. Of course, had that nasty leg break last year. And even at the Valencia test, he wasn't 100%. He's had the winter off, so there's going to be a lot of people just looking at how he's able to come back throughout this pre-season period. Because I think at the end of last year, there were some concerns. Is he ever going to be able to get back to his best? It was such a horrible injury.
Yeah, to try and put that into context, Alex Rins had the crash in the Tiso sprint in Mugello back in June, both his tibia and fibula. He had to have an external fixator on his leg for a long period of time after that. Such was the damage to his leg. He wasn't really the same at all for the rest of 2023, was he? We did see him fleetingly through the second half of the season, but he was clearly not riding 100%. He was in pain. He then had to have further treatment after Australia because he had a hernia on his leg as well. So Alex Rins wasn't really fully fit for any of the second half of last season. So that is, I guess, the big unknown from a Rins point of view, because I think many of us thought that Alex Rins, from a stylist point of view, was born to ride a Yamaha.
Yeah.
We just need to see whether he's fit enough to ride it 100%.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it was a big surprise on other people at the time when he signed for Honda this time last year, that it had signed for Honda, because you just felt moving across from the Suzuki, it was a perfect match. But anyway, it may well be 12 months late, but it's finally happened anyway. Right, Lewis, stick with us for now, because I don't think we're too far away from the presentation getting underway. An opportunity to cross back live to Malaysia, are we? Are we going to chat with Jack Gorst? No, not yet. In fact, Lewis will stay with us, just because you might as well. There's no point getting rid of you just yet before we move across to Malaysia, and he is ready now. Let's hear from Jack Gorst, shall we, just to sample some of the atmosphere before this Yamaha presentation officially gets underway. The garage door was down, it's now up, the covers are on, the covers are about to be off. Jack, tell us what it's like down there.
Yeah, it's quite nice down here. It's a nice event that Yamaha have put on. They've put on a special event just for the journalists and professional photographers that have made the effort to travel out here for the first test of the year. So as we can see now, it's slowly starting to fill up with those journalists that have made their way down from the media centre. And this is, of course, the main attraction behind me that they're all here to have a look at. Those two Yamaha YZR M1s underneath the covers, will they be a little bit different colour scheme? We don't know. We hope so, but I mean, the livery is still quite nice. Anyway, it's going to be a big year anyway for Yamaha, of course, as you mentioned there with Alex Rins coming in. Also, the questions about his leg. It's definitely quite a massive year for him on his side, but also then for Fabio as well. And that all translates to Yamaha making sure that the bike underneath those covers is as competitive as it can come be. and preferably more competitive than it has been in last year's. But as you can see, just to the right, if we do spin round a little bit, you can see that all the journalists are starting to come in to grab a quick look at these bikes, as well as the riders, of course, themselves. And there will be an opportunity after this where they're going to cart everyone across to the hospitality that we have just at the back of the garages here. And there'll be a little Q&A session with the riders there. So it's all starting to kick off here, Jack. Not too sure how long we've got left to go, but I'll pass back over to you. And it should be a good event to enjoy anyway.
Yeah, Jack, if you can, I think you can still hear me okay. Do me a favour. I don't want to get you in trouble here, yeah. But could you just give us, like, just before we go to the live video, just lift up the cover just a little bit, just to see maybe just a flash of the new livery, can you? Are you able to do? Go on. I'll take the blame for it. Run across and just do it quickly.
I would. I would, but I know that Lynn Jarvis likes his rugby, so I might get rugby tackled by him. So I'm not going to try that, actually, Jack. Maybe if you come here next year, you can do it.
It wouldn't be my job if I didn't try and get you in trouble. And good decision in the end. I've not seen Lynn Jarvis tackle anybody, but yeah, I'm sure he's pretty fierce in a rugby tackle. So cheers, Jack. Thank you very much indeed. Great to chat with you. We'll catch up with you to hear some live interviews once the presentation's done.
Yeah, cheers, boys. See you later.
So there we go. Right, officially, I think we should get 2024 underway, shall we, for the Yamaha boys. New lineup for this year, Fabio Quartararo and Alex Rins. And this is it, the team presentation for the Monster Energy Yamaha squad in 2024.
Hello everyone, I'm Simon Crafer. We're in Malaysia, inside the paddock at Sepang Circuit. This is a very important moment because the tests that mark the beginning of the new MotoGP season are scheduled to start. Yamaha has an important mission this year, return to winning. And it's a desire that can be felt throughout the team. You can tell by looking at the work of every team member engaged and focused in preparation for this season. With the attention and sensitivity that this moment requires, I will introduce you to the protagonists of this season for the Monster Energy Yamaha MotoGP team. Let's go. I first met Lynn Jarvis in Sepang here, 1999, 25 years ago, when he became the managing director of Yamaha's MotoGP project. Back then the riders were Abe, Checa, Biaggi, Lacconi, and myself. 25 years at the highest level, that's some experience. And here he is. Hey Lynn.
Hey. Sam.
Always good to see you.
How are you? You well?
Really good, really good. Oh, I was wondering if you have some time for us.
Sure, why not? Just take a walk.
Okay. Lynn, you have experience with many MotoGP race season preparations. Mm-hmm. On the eve of the start of the 24 MotoGP season, please give us your personal feelings.
Yeah, indeed. The beginning of every year is always a moment of big anticipation, I would say. And, especially, it's quite typical we begin here in Sepang, and this is the first moment when everybody's here together. So whatever we've done in the winter, we get to the moment of truth that's coming up soon. So indeed, I've done quite a few. I was remembering even this morning that my first one here was with Max Biaggi back in the day when we were Marlboro Yamaha. But every year is different, but every year it's exciting. The anticipation is there, and I'm really curious how we're going to feel in 4 days from now.
Lynn, we can see you have a very focused and determined team. Can you tell us about the internal changes within Yamaha's organisation, including the arrival of Massimo Bartolini?
Yeah, we've made some changes in our way of working. I would say this process started in reality in the middle of last year. We knew we needed to get some fresh, should we say, fresh blood, fresh input, new ideas, and we needed to change our way of working. So in that period of time, I would say really since the third quarter of last year, we've taken a couple of engineers, in fact, key engineers from the paddock, from other competitors. They've joined our team, and the one, as you mentioned, Massimo Bartolini's name, the interesting thing there is that he was being brought in as technical director. So it's the first time we've really seen a European on such a high level within the Yamaha factory racing MotoGP project. He will be working alongside Masuda. Masuda-san is formerly our testing leader, and he's now joined us as the project leader. So we're going to see the project leader and Massimo Bartolini basically combining their efforts together to change our working methods outside of Japan by working much more with the European expertise. But then Masuda's job is to make that work inside Japan. So the target at the end of the day is to be more fast, more aggressive, more adventurous, and really to get rid of that conservatism. And so this is the plan.
Speaking of the technical side, tell us how you think the concessions will affect Yamaha.
Well, I think that there'll be a big assistance. It's of course not only Yamaha, it's also Honda and Yamaha. We have the possibility to do a lot more things that we couldn't do without having the concessions. In particular, of course, the testing. So we're allowed to test on many more circuits than normally you're restricted to work on a limited number of tracks. We're allowed to do those tests with our factory riders and not only with the test team riders. We're allowed to change the specification of the engine throughout the season, obviously still within the rules, but we can change the engine design as the season progresses. And we have also one extra aerodynamics package that we can bring. So the concessions give us the opportunity to work. It's up to us to make the maximum effect of that and to make sure that we keep making progress. So it allows us to not be, in a way, not be stuck with where we start at the beginning of the season. We should be able to continue to make progress throughout the year.
Fantastic.
So let's hope it works.
Both riders' contracts expire at the end of 2024, and the performance of the new Yamaha M1 will influence their decisions. What are your expectations?
Yeah, it's absolutely like that. I think that the action on the track is going to be very exciting this year, but I think the action off the track is going to be equally intense, because it's true that our riders, both contracts expire at the end of this season, but it's the same for so many other riders in the paddock. I think probably 20 out of the 23 riders' contracts expire. So for keeping our riders, it's very important that we show what we can do, how we've been able to bounce back, how we can be more competitive, but also more than that, what is the expectation, the hope for the future. It affects the confidence our riders have, but also it will affect the choice of satellite team, because of course we want to come back in 2025 with a satellite team as well, but in order to do that, same story, we need to be competitive. So it's a super important season, and I would say the first half of the season is really crucial for many things.
Finally, Lynn, it looks like you have consistency with your sponsors. Any news?
Yeah, indeed, as you've seen. Anyway, the look and feel is very much similar to last year. And this is thanks to our title sponsor. We've been with Monster now 12 years as team sponsor, and this is the sixth year of title sponsorship. So I'm super, super grateful to have Monster with us. And indeed, all of our other sponsors stayed with us. And we have one addition, which is the call of the blue. And that is the Yamaha Motor India's marketing phrase. And we can thank that to the expanding championship, where now we go to India for the race. And the importance of MotoGP in the Asian markets is super important for us. And I think for the championship too.
Lynn, as always, thank you for your time and best of luck on the mission.
Yeah, thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Massimo, just the man I was looking for.
Nice to see you.
You too, buddy. Do you have a moment for us to ask a few questions?
Yeah, sure.
Let's do it. Massimo, I'd like to know how your winter was and how hard you and everyone at Yamaha have been working in preparation for this season.
Yeah, definitely, I think it has been the shortest winter ever, but I would like also to say very productive, because we have been able to do a lot of work, both in both headquarters in Japan, but also in Italy, with the result that we could prepare a lot of material to test in Sepang during the first test of the season. And furthermore, we have been able also to improve the structure of the team with the arrival of Max Bartolini, and also Alex Rins joined us, and for me it's another step in that direction.
You also mentioned Alex Rins, your new rider. What are your first impressions of him?
Yeah, you know, we did only one day test in Valencia, but the impression has been good. At the beginning, we tried to gather information from him, from his previous experience. You know, for them, it takes not so much time to get used of the new bike. So the two runs were the most important. Then we didn't put on him any pressure, and from that moment he started asking questions to us to adapt himself to the M1, and we didn't even force him to try time attack, because he had a really bad injury, he had a really long break during the season, he could not ride the bike. He did the last race in Valencia, but his physical condition was not at 100%. So we really wanted to take the most of this day, but without putting on him any kind of pressure.
Finally, it's a very important year, 2024, for Yamaha. On the eve of this new season, please give us your thoughts.
You know, all the seasons are very important, but especially for us, after two difficult seasons, it's the real moment to come back where we were used to be, because it's an important year. All the rider agreements are expiring at the end of the season. As you know, the importance to have a satellite team is fundamental, and in this moment we need to show to everybody that the way that we started now is it's a good one. We need to show the performance of our bike.
Massimo, thank you very much for your time. I can't wait to see your new bikes.
You're welcome, mate.
In the Yamaha garage, you can feel the atmosphere is full of energy and concentration. Next, I would like to speak to someone who probably more than anyone else wants to return to winning. Excuse me, Mark.
Oh, yeah. Good, how you doing?
Good. I was wondering, can you tell us where Fabio is?
He was here earlier, but you can bet if he's not here now, he's probably in the gym.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Thank you.
See you, mate.
It's exciting times for the Monster Energy Yamaha team and all their fans, because they have two of the most talented riders on the planet. I think it's clear for everyone to see. Fabio was fighting for the win in MotoGP from when he first arrived. He's continued to have that ability, and he does it crashing so seldomly. It's something not many riders can do. Then you look on the other side of the garage. This year, it's Alex Rins. On what was arguably the least competitive machine on the grid last year, he won in Austin. Truly amazing. Can you imagine what these two riders could achieve on the new M1? We're at the hotel Fabio is staying. Now we only have to find the gym. As expected, Fabio is in full pre-season training mode. Hey Fabio.
How are you, Simon?
Really good, buddy. Sorry to bother you. Do you have a few minutes for us?
Yeah, in 10 minutes I finish and I will come to you.
Thank you. I'll wait out by the pool.
Perfect. Hey Simon.
Hey, thanks for joining us, buddy. Really good. Fabio, tell us, how was the winter period for you? Recovery from a hard season last year and training in preparation for this season?
Yeah, I think that as everybody knows, 2023 season was tough for Yamaha, for me. But I think this winter was really productive. I think that I've trained better than ever. I'm feeling super well, and yeah, I think that you know, it's really a motivate way to start the test, and of course with new people. So I'm really looking forward, and I think that you know, training hard on the winter will help a lot.
The 2024 season is about to start. How do you feel about it?
You know, before to start the season, you always feel super. You know, you really want to be back on the bike. We will have a lot of testing, a lot of races, so we will take it step by step. Hopefully here in Malaysia we'll make a step forward compared to last year, and from this moment I think we have to build up our confidence and start to get the result like in the past.
Speaking of confidence, how important will it be for you personally to return to winning?
Personally, it's my main goal. I mean, I only see this in my mind. Of course, maybe it will be a short process or a long one, but this is what I want, and I will achieve it together with Yamaha this year. And I think that is important to always, to never skip some steps, you know. We have been, like I said, 2023 was really tough. We cannot expect straight away to be fighting for the title and for the victory. I think we have to build up step by step with a solid top five, then fighting for the podium, then for the win. And I think this is the steps we have to manage. Of course, my personal goal is always to be world champion, to win every race. But we have to think that we have still a lot of job to do, and hopefully we are on a good way to do it.
You have a new teammate. What do you expect from Alex Rins?
Well, Alex is a really fast guy. I know him since a really long time. I think one of the first riders I've ever met when I go to Spain. I had maybe 7 or 8 years old, so it's a really long time. He made some really good races, some wins. So of course, I think myself and especially Yamaha have a lot of expectation on Alex. And I think it will be great to have him and heard a little bit about his comments about the bike.
Thank you for your time, Fabio. We'd also like to hear from Alex Rins. Do you have any idea where he is?
Well, for sure Alex will be at his office trying a new leather, seeing his new helmet or something like that, so you will find it there.
Thank you, buddy.
Thank you. See you, Simon.
See you, buddy. Hey, Alex. How are you,
hey, Simon.
Buddy?
How's it going?
Really good, mate.
Very good.
Good to see you.
Yeah.
We heard you had a new suit.
Yeah?
Yeah.
New colors, you like?
Yeah, beautiful. Does it fit?
It fits properly.
Okay. Perfect, perfect. Awesome, buddy. Look forward to see you in it. Hey, do you have a few moments for us to ask you
a few questions about
this year?
Take a seat with me.
Of course. Thank you. So, tell us, are you ready for the Monster Energy Yamaha experience?
I'm fully ready. I'm so excited to start this new adventure because, you know, it is a dream come true to be here in this team, a team with a lot of name and a lot of history, no, on the past. So I'm super excited to start this new season, this new adventure with the Yamaha Monster Factory team.
Yeah, with a factory behind you. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
So the first question has to be, are you recovered? How you feel after surgeries and the tough year last season?
I'm feeling ready. I'm feeling recovered. Still sometimes walking, the change of the pressure, change of the weather is affecting me a little bit on the leg, on the injury. Still recovering since the crash, because as you know and as I explained, I lost a lot of bone, so this one takes time. What I'm talking about, it takes a lot of time to recover. But yeah, this winter I start to do a normal life, normal trainings. Also I jump on the R1M, on the street bike, prepared for the circuit. I jump in Almeria and Valencia, and I didn't feel any pain, any extra pain on the leg, so this is so important.
Great news. You had the chance to work with a little, for the first time, your new team at last year's Valencia Fest. Can you give us your first impressions of the team?
Well, my first impressions of the team, of that test that we did in Valencia after the race, it was so good. I felt so comfortable with the team. They looks like they want to improve the bike, to improve the results. So more or less same dynamic as myself, no? So I'm ready to bring, no, all my experience with the MotoGP bikes to them, and to see if we can do this bike, this Yamaha bike, competitive again.
Speaking of that, have you seen the new M1? The new M1. Have you seen it?
I've seen it.
And the first impression?
It looks amazing. Cool. It looks spectacular. Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Your new suit. We saw it a little on the way in. Can you tell us about it? Can we see it?
Yeah, for sure. So, as you can see, I will use different color for this season. I'm wearing the Alpine Star ones. That I'm with them since 2017, when I jumped in MotoGP. And I'm feeling super, super well with the suit, you know. I don't know in the past when you were racing, but right now.
They look lighter.
Looks so light, yeah. And also when it's brand new, like this one, when you fit in, it is perfect.
Immediately. Not like needing to run
exactly,
in like
that one. Exactly. I remember in the past when I was more young, also some leather suits,
you need to get them wet.
Exactly. So right now it fits perfectly, super fast. And yeah, this one is the suit with the airbag. That helps us a lot on the crashes. When it deploys, it covers all the shoulders and also the ribs.
They've come a long way.
I'm just, as a new member on the team, I'm discussing with my guys, what do you think, black or white? The knee slider.
Good question. I would say if I had an opinion, but to be honest, I don't care. It looks good. It will look
good
either way.
It looks amazing, yeah, for sure.
Yeah, really appreciate your time. Thank you for talking
to
us.
Thanks to you.
And we look forward to see you soon together.
Exactly.
With the new M1.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, buddy.
Thank you.
Catch you soon. Oh, I believe we might have the opportunity to see Fabio's new helmet. There he is.
How are you?
Good, buddy. Good. Would you mind showing that to to us?
Yes.
Explaining it?
So this is a 2024 race helmet, much more clean and aggressive devil face. We add some graffiti on the side, on the back. The back of the helmet is white, but in the past used to be more dark. And I think it's a really cool helmet. I think one of the best I ever had. So hopefully you can shine on top.
Thank you. I look forward to see you with your new M1 really soon at the unveiling. See you there.
See you there.
Thank you to Yamaha for giving us the opportunity to witness the atmosphere of this important moment. We've spoken with management, we've met with riders, we've been inside the garage at the start of a new season. And now it's time for the moment you've all been waiting for, the unveiling of the new Yamaha M1. Say both you and your machines look fantastic. Fabio, we'll start with you. Please tell us your first impressions of the new M1.
Well, first impression, you know, like I said, for me the most important is how fast it goes, but of course, you know, Yamaha livery is always super nice, so yeah, really looking forward to start the season.
Thank you and best of luck. Alex, tell us what you think of your new Yamaha.
Well, as Fabio said, the bike looks unbelievable, so I'm more ready than ever.
We wish you luck as well, Alex. Thank you all for following this exclusive Yamaha preview. Please continue to follow this fantastic team because a new chapter in MotoGP is about to be written.
To Simon Crafar there, a whistle-stop tour of Sepang from the circuit to the hotel, back to the circuit, and then just in time to be able to see that brand new 2024 Yamaha M1. Well, brand new, unchanged Yamaha M1. The livery, some very, very small changes here or there, but let's be perfectly honest. It's exactly the same as last year, but I liked last year, so that's fine. Right, quiz time for you guys before we head across live to the Sepang International Circuit to speak to Alex Rins. And this one is about Rins here. What's his favourite TV show? Is it The Simpsons? Is it Family Guy? Let us know, A or B, and we'll tell you the answer in a few moments' time. But let's hear from the man himself, shall we? Of course, this, his third factory, his third team in the space of 3 years, making the switch from Suzuki to LCR Honda and now to Yamaha. And as we said, this could be a historic year for the Spaniard as he looks to become the first MotoGP rider in history to win with three different manufacturers. He's going to be fighting for that alongside Jack Miller, who of course has already tasted victory for Honda and Ducati, and now he's looking to do it this year with KTM, and for Maverick Viñales as well, who has managed to taste victory with Suzuki and Yamaha, but he's still awaiting that first Aprilia victory. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if all three of those guys are able to take a Grand Prix win this year, but which one of them will be first and which one of them will be the man to set history and become the very first to have won three Grand Prix with three different factories. We'll be hearing from the 42 in just a few moments' time. But a couple of tidbits, a couple of snippets to take away from that. In particular, the chat right at the start with Lynn Jarvis spoke about the arrival of Massimo Bartolini. He's come across with one other Ducati engineer, with Max Bartolini now fronting up the technical department for Yamaha. They've managed to go out into the market, swoop up a couple of Ducati engineers, which of course we saw KTM do this time last year so successfully. Now Yamaha doing the same as well. But before we talk about that in detail, let's head across live to Malaysia. Jack Gorst is there with the number 42, Yamaha's new arrival, Alex Rins.
Yeah, here with Alex. Obviously, Alex, an exciting time here unveiling the new bike and also in new colours for yourself this year. Firstly, you of course had some days on the bike already. Just tell us, how did the shakedown go?
Yeah, the shakedown was quite good. We were able to ride 2 days. So we tested many things. Unlucky in the afternoon, it was coming some rain. So it rained a little bit. But overall, we are quite happy because we anticipate a little bit of work. As you heard, we have many new parts behind these panels. So yeah, we did it a good work. We are following the same line, so yeah, I'm happy.
One of the big concerns, Alex, for fans of yours is just how your leg is after that big injury last year. You say that it's not too bad now, it's almost there, and you had no pain on the bike during the shakedown. So just tell us, how does it feel out there?
Yeah, my leg is more or less fine. It's much better than before, than the last time I jumped on the bike in Valencia. So I was a bit scared because, you know, we tested with another bikes during this pre-season with the street bikes, and it's not the same as the MotoGP bike, no? But yeah, on the first day, I jumped on the bike and immediately I didn't feel pain. So this are good news.
And Alex, we just have two fan questions for you, actually. The first one comes from Hugo da Costa, and he asked, Alex, how would it feel if you won a race with another new manufacturer?
Well, it will be a dream come true in the end. Right now we are in Yamaha, and for sure, if I get a victory in this team, it will be a really, really grateful, no?
Well, of course, you're going for that record as well, the first to win with three different manufacturers in the MotoGP era. The second fan question, Alex, comes from Tiana MD. Which track are you most excited to race at this year?
Well, mostly in many races, because as you know, last year I missed like 10 racers or something, 10 races, sorry, or something like this. So yeah, I'm really excited to jump on the bike and start racing again.
Well, good luck to see you on the bike tomorrow, Alex, and good luck for the test as well.
Good to hear there from Alex Rins in a confident mood ahead of his new campaign getting underway with the Yamaha squad. You saw the fan questions there that were submitted on Instagram. This is a good time to remind you. Of course, if you're not following us on Instagram already, why not? But this is a perfect time to do it. We're going to be getting lots of videos on our stories from what's happening in Sepang. Plus, we'll give you the opportunity on one of our stories to suggest some questions for the four team presentations we've got next week coming up. KTM, Repsol Honda, LCR Honda and Aprilia. Check out MotoGP's Instagram stories to be able to put your questions in. And of course, with Qatar now, what are we, about a month away, 5 weeks away? If you are wanting to have a bucket list trip to a MotoGP rounds this year, then check out the MotoGP hospitality options, which will be the perfect way for you to get up close and personal with the likes of Alex Rins and Fabio Quartararo. Right, we asked you, which TV show is Alex Rins a big fan of? There we go. The correct answer, which two-thirds of you got correct, was The Simpsons. A big Bart Simpson fan, I believe, is Alex Rins. I imagine as he tries to pass the time on the flight across to Malaysia, he may well have had a couple of episodes downloaded. But it was nice to see that Alex was in a confident mood there. Of course, we'll be looking at his progress throughout the test just to see how that leg holds up. Fingers crossed, I think I speak on behalf of most, where we hope that Alex Rins is back to his very, very best this year. And he has a motorcycle that's competitive enough for him to show it. Next. Quiz question have we got, or are we going with a poll? Going with a poll. This one, going to be an interesting one. Can Yamaha fight for the World Championship this year? Yes or no? Of course. At their first winless MotoGP season in, what was it, 2 decades? Last time out, which would, to me, indicate very unlikely that they are going to be world champions this year, given how much of a struggle it was in 2023. But we've seen stranger things happen. As we said, one of the strongest lineups on the grid. If we can get that bike right, of course, the arrival of not only a former F1 engineer in Luca Marbarini, but Max Bartolini as well, now heading up the technical side, technical director, I believe his new title is, working alongside Sumi-san, who was the project leader. So they've got the right brains there. They're not afraid to go out and headhunt and try and bring some new ideas to the table. So maybe that is going to be the fresh start that Yamaha need to get themselves back to fighting for the World Championship, which of course they won in 2021. How long ago does that feel now? Lots of you have been getting in touch. Please continue to do so, including a Silver Suzuki. I'd love to get to ride an R1M, the Oregon Raceway, and then the Ridge in Washington as well. A couple of American circuits. I'm aware of the Ridge, not of Oregon Raceway, but the R1M, of course, which is the superbike, the top superbike that Yamaha provide. This coming in from Belgium. Nancy, just saying, from Belgium. Great to see you, Nancy. Thanks for joining us. Hope you're enjoying it. I'm sure you are a big Fabio Quartararo fan, like I am as well. Before we cross live to Fabio Quartararo, let's just throw another quiz question in your way, this time about the 2021 World Champion, the Frenchman. What tattoo does Fabio Quartararo have on his right arm? Is it Rihanna's phone number, who, of course, he caught up with in Paris a couple of weeks ago? Not jealous. Very, very cool indeed. Or is it his first MotoGP win? Well, we're going to cross live. We might be able to see the right arm of Fabio Quartararo. Get your notepad and pen ready, because if it is Rihanna's phone number, I think there's going to be a few of you jotting it down, me included. Right, let's head across to Sepang then and hear from the 2021 world champion, Fabio Quartararo. He's alongside Jack.
Fabio, thank you for waiting around for us. Firstly, you've of course had a few days on the bike already. We know that Yamaha bringing lots and lots of new parts, some new improvements. How was your first feeling with the 2024 M1?
Yeah, I think was great. We had 2 days, not a lot of laps, as the weather is pretty bad here in the afternoon. But first laps was good. We could try some things positive. Of course, I think the potential is there, but we have to find our way to find the potential to be really, really used on track.
And we heard from Lynn as well that Yamaha have been reacting a lot to changing the way they work, their structure. How positive is that for you to see from your side as a rider, knowing that there's more possibility now for improvements with a bike?
I think it's important because, you know, the reaction time now looks like it's much shorter. Like we said in the past, you know, we try to change a little bit the Japanese mentality in more European. And I think it's working quite a lot. But like I said, we need time to really be back to the top, and hopefully soon we will see our potential and feel it on track.
And Fabio, we just have a couple of fan questions for you as well. Firstly, comes from MS Rush River. What's the one thing you couldn't live without whilst traveling during the season?
I think my headphones. I'm listening music all the time, when I wake up, when I'm traveling, when I'm on the plane. So I think this is one of the most important things that I'm using.
And the second one, Fabio, it comes from Kev. If you could eat only one more thing for the rest of your life, what would it be?
Eat? Not thinking about healthy or whatever.
Whatever you like.
Yeah, of course, if I had to keep me healthy, I would say, you know, chicken, rice and vegetables. But if I have to say only one thing, I would say pizza pepperoni.
What was it?
Pizza.
I thought you would have said McDonald's.
Yeah, but pizza is, I feel it's one step better.
Okay, thank you, Fabio. Thank you very much.
Great to hear from Fabio Quartararo, just like Alex Rins, confident of the changes that have been made at Yamaha, talking about that culture change from a Japanese mentality to a European mentality. Of course, we saw in MotoGP last year, the European manufacturers, Ducati, KTM, Aprilia, able to react that much quicker. And of course, the Japanese, if they want to try and get themselves back to the summit of the World Championship, are having to adopt that kind of mentality themselves, which Fabio has been pushing for. We've heard last year from Marc Marquez and in 2022 as well that he was pushing for the same thing at Honda, and it looks as though they are reacting, they are changing to try and see themselves a little bit more competitive in 2024. Right, quiz results. I hope most of you got this one right. 26% if you're saying Rihanna's phone number. Maybe they were just hopeful, like me, but no. He may well have Rihanna's phone number. That's one for us to ask next time we see Fabio. But of course, he has a tattoo of his very first MotoGP win, Jerez 2020. Who can forget that fateful day, of course, when Marc Marquez had that huge high side, which certainly changed the complexion of the World Championship right up until today. A memorable day in the history of the MotoGP World Championship, and Fabio has that photo tattooed on his right arm. Right, let's talk to you about trying to get yourself booked in to come and watch MotoGP in 2024. 21 rounds coming your way from the start of March all the way through to the end of November. Qatar to Valencia, plenty of trips in between over to the US, and then we'll be across in Southeast Asia, in Malaysia, of course, come October and November. Now, the best time for you to go and grab your tickets. There's some good discounts in there as well, including for Portimao, I believe, up until the next couple of weeks, I believe. You can make sure that you get your seats sorted for the Portuguese Grand Prix, round two of the year, where I'm pretty sure there's going to be quite the atmosphere, as Miguel Oliveira looks to make amends after everything that went down last year. Some comments have been flowing through as well. Alex Rins will have the same influence as Quartararo in developing the bike. Is that a question? Is that a statement? If it is a question, then yes, he will. And if it is a statement, then well done, Mr. Is Motorsport. You are switched on and know exactly what is happening. Yeah, Alex, of course, will be very much helping develop this Yamaha. It will not be Fabio completely taking the lead. Fabio, of course, I think we can safely say will be the number one rider, but only just. I think it's going to be a joint effort for them throughout 2024. Matt, the mad botanist, is at it again. I tell you what, you are now, what are we, 6 for 6, 5 for 5? I forget how many we've done now. Matt clearly is at home and should be spending more time looking to try find a job than watching these team presentations, because he's got too much time on his hands. But I think the concessions are going to be big for both Yamaha and Honda this year. I hope we see some more competition for Ducati. 2024 is on. Yeah, completely agree with that. And I have to say, from what we've seen at the Sepang shakedown, Pedro Acosta being able to go as fast as he has done on this 2024 KTM is a great sign for them. Aprilia are going to take a step. That is for certain. Now that Miguel Oliveira is on a full factory bike, and Honda are definitely going to be there. Will Yamaha be? Let's find out. The main man himself, the big boss down there, Lynn Jarvis, is now alongside Jack, talking live.
Yep, we're here with Lynn, obviously the big boss of the Yamaha MotoGP team. Lynn, you said there in the presentation that this wasn't like starting from zero, but it's a very important part in Yamaha's timeline. Can you just expand on what you meant by that? Is that to do with kind of the restructuring that we've seen recently?
Yes, in fact, as I mentioned, it's the beginning of a new period. We need to recover, I would say. Last year was a very difficult year for us. Just a couple of years before, we were champion. Then we were second, and last year we struggled. It was really, really difficult. And it was clear and obvious that we need to, in order to become competitive, we need to change many things. So we started probably middle of last season with restructuring and having new ideas, new partners, new collaboration, and changing our internal organization as well. So really this shakedown test that we just completed and this first test is the first time we start to bring it all together. And we know it's not going to be instant, but it's the beginning of a fight back. It's the beginning of a recovery.
And of course, your rider lineup this year has changed with Alex Rins stepping in alongside Fabio Quartararo, two of, well, as everyone agrees, two of the best riders in the paddock as well. What's it like having those two characters and managing them and making sure that both of them are happy whilst attempting to not only bring Yamaha back to winning, but also winning themselves and beating each other?
Yeah, anyway, it's still early, so I can't say exactly how it is to have both. But what pleases me is instantly there's a very good chemistry between them. So I really have the feeling that they're going to collaborate together. They appreciate each other and they're on the same mission. You know, they understand that they need to work together with us and we have to do whatever we can to come back. Alex obviously is one of the most fastest riders in MotoGP, has been a little inconsistent in the past, but in the last couple of seasons, both on Suzuki and then on Honda, he's been winning races. Fabio, we know his capacity being a champion already in 21. So I think we have a great combination, and they're on a mission, and so I'm very optimistic that we should work well together.
That's my last question, really, about the optimism and the confidence within the team with the restructuring, a new rider pairing. How do you feel about the Yamaha team coming into this year?
I'm positive. I'm optimistic because I've seen the changes. I know the changes we're making. But I'm also not unrealistic. There's no quick recovery. To arrive in the situation where we were being uncompetitive is a gradual process. We have to not make it a gradual process to recover, but we do not underestimate the level of our competitors. If you look especially at Ducati, you look at KTM, and then we have Aprilia and Honda and us. So it's not easy. It's a super competitive series, but I think we've made good changes, and if we can all make it work together and speed up. More than anything, we need to speed up the way that we work. And anyway, the challenge is on us. We have to deliver.
We look forward to seeing it, Lynn. Thank you very much.
Always fascinating to be able to hear from Lynn Jarvis, a man with so much experience, so much success in the paddock. You feel if you want anybody inside a MotoGP team to try and spearhead you forward after a couple of difficult seasons, then he is definitely the man. And he spoke about there what a big year it is for Yamaha, not only to try and find themselves being a little bit more competitive, but as he referenced in the team presentation as well, for two reasons. Not only does Fabio Quartararo and Alex Rins's contract come up at the end of the year, with Quartararo already throughout last year saying that he won't be afraid to look at other options if Yamaha can't bring him a bike that's competitive. But also, they still only have two bikes on the grid. They've made it no secret. They want an independent team. And that really comes down to the bike being competitive. There was a lot of talk about the possibility of VR46 maybe making a switch across for 2025. But fascinatingly, at their team launch, Uccio Salucci said that he's hoping to sign a Ducati extension before the season gets underway. He said 10 to 15 days are going to be absolutely vital for the future of that team. And, well, 10 days have passed. We're still awaiting news. Maybe we'll hear something at Sepang. I'm sure the journalists there are going to be sticking a microphone under the nose of Uccio Salucci and some of the Ducati key men as well, just to find out where those negotiations are at. And on that point, can Yamaha fight for the World Championship this year? Let us know. We teased it before. Now an opportunity for you to put in the comments, in the chat, A for yes, if you think that one of Alex Rins or Fabio Quartararo, maybe even both, can compete for the World Championship this year. And no, if you think that it's going to be a step too far in 2024. Lots of you, well, I'm sure, will be responding to that, just like you've been getting in touch in the chat. Let's have a look at what a couple of you are saying. For me, oh, thank you, Rizal. Very kind of you. Arsenal badge as well. Very happy man, I imagine, after last night's result. What do you expect of this team for 2024 MotoGP World Championship? I imagine we're talking about Yamaha. Good question. Do I personally think they can fight for the World Championship this year? No, I don't think they can. I think it's going to be a step too far for them to bounce back in that greater success. Can they win races? Can they be regular podium contenders with that lineup? Absolutely. And I think if by the end of the season they've got both riders inside the top 10 in the World Championship, with maybe Alex, Fabio Quartararo challenging to get back inside the top six, top five in the World Championship. I think that has to be deemed as a successful year as they look to rebuild and refine that path towards World Championship glory. Jerry asking a question as well. How confident does Yamaha feel against the Ducatis this year? A difficult one to answer when we've not seen any Ducatis on track in 2024 just yet. I mean, all the indications are that Ducati, Gigi Delinea, Pecco Bagnaia, Jorge Martin and Ebbia Sainz, the list goes on, are going to be taking another step forward, which means they're going to be very, very difficult to stop this year. So if I had to say right now, I think that confidence levels of them beating Ducati may well be quite low. But as we go throughout pre-season testing, let's see how everything unfolds. Let's see who has got the pace. Of course, after the flag, the best way to be able to find out who is in the best shape heading towards round one of the year. Cypress Sad asking a question as well, or is it? Oh no, just a statement. Rins will not only be the first rider to win with three different manufacturers, but also in consecutive years. Well, look at you, Cypress. You've been doing your research over the off-season. Congratulations, of course, was victorious in the final race of 2021 with Suzuki. Then was victorious last year. No, sorry, final race of 2022. There we go. It all blends into one year with Suzuki. Then at the America's Grand Prix in 2023 with Honda. And we're hoping to try and do it in 2024 with Yamaha. That a question I'm sure that my good friend Jack Gorse will be firing the way of team boss Maya Merigali, who's there in Sepang to chat to us live.
Maya, firstly, thank you for your time. Of course, we have to talk to you about a couple of things. Importantly, one is Alex Rins coming into the team and forming this new pairing with Fabio Quartararo as well. What are your views on that, and how do you think that those two riders will do this year?
I really believe that this year rider lineup is very good. I actually have been impressed about Alex two first days, because he did one test in Valencia in November, but for sure he was not fit. The day in Valencia was not ideal, but as he started here and has he kept working and riding, has been a really nice surprise for us, because the comment, the way to work, very calm, explaining things very well. It has been good. So what we really, and I'm really hoping, is that they will work together. I know that at the end, you know, they have always to beat each other, but in a really good way. I hope that they will push the other one and rising the level of them, but also to help us to develop the bike.
And that's the big question, really, the level of the bike this year. Of course, we've already had a couple of days on track thanks to the new concessions this year with both Fabio and Alex. What was their initial feedback on the updates that Yamaha have brought?
Yeah, so far we had good feedbacks, mainly from the aerodynamics and also from the engine. Unfortunately, we could only ride in the morning, because in the afternoon we had big rain in both days. But the feeling we got from them and the data we have been able to gather has been good. You know, also the track was in a good condition, because lap time were quite fast. And now I'm really curious to see what will be next, because from tomorrow to Thursday, all the riders will be here, so I'm seeing that maybe the limit will be even move higher, and then we will see exactly where we are.
That's quite a nice record as well for Alex to chase. He could become the first rider in the MotoGP era to win with three different manufacturers. Do you reckon he'll achieve that this year?
Sure. No, but you know, last year he has been the only one that he was able to beat the Honda, the Ducati, sorry, with a different manufacturer. And no, we didn't have any doubt on him. Our decision has been only on him. We started discussing with him the year before. And for us, it's really important to have two riders on the same level, because having only a factory team without satellite, already we have an additional amount of job that we have to do by ourselves. And with two fast riders, this will help a bit.
Thank you, Maya. Thank you very much.
So there we go, Mayo Merigali previewing what's to come for Yamaha in 2024. I will be crossing back live one final time to Jack just to get a little bit of a roundup of what he feels that the general consensus is, what the mood is down there ahead of a big new season getting underway, and of course what the atmosphere within the paddock is like. Jack has been chatting to some of the riders today ahead of the Sepang test getting underway tomorrow. And right on cue, if you do want to follow the Sepang test, of course, as we said, we've got After the Flag coming your way at 5:30 local time. You can watch that through the MotoGP app. Also on there as well, there'll be a live text updating you with all of the happenings from the Sepang International Circuit. Live timing is available on there as well. We'll be posting plenty of interviews and reaction to all of the key stories from the Sepang test. So if you haven't already, on both iOS and Android, you can download the new MotoGP app now ahead of the new season and ahead of the Sepang test getting underway tomorrow. A man that is going to be extremely busy for the next 3 days trying to keep up to speed with everything that is going on is a man that is going to be fronting After the Flag for 3 days straight. 90 minutes of the best analysis and reaction. He'll be helped, of course, and quite brilliantly as ever, by Elliot York, Simon Crafer and Jack Gorst as well. It is Lewis Sutterby, who we spoke to beforehand. So we'll bring Lewis in to preview what to expect on After the Flag. It's going to be three busy days, Lewis. Looking forward to it?
Very much so. We've already had the appetite whetted, as we mentioned earlier on, by Pedro Acosta's performance already in the test, setting low 158. But this is the first time since the Valencia test that we've seen all 22 riders on track together. Or certainly we hope so, once Frankie Morbidelli arrives and hopefully he's declared fit to run. There are so many stories to look forward to going to this season, whether Ducati can maintain their dominance and whether the rest can close the gap. And speaking of Yamaha specifically, one thing that I think we want to try and learn in this upcoming test, the two tests that we have, is whether Yamaha can get a grip on their qualifying performance. I think that was the main thing that really held them back last year, is, and it became apparent during the Sepang test last year, that Yamaha just did not have the single lap performance in qualifying. Fabio Quartararo just could not put a time attack on the board that was anything like comparable to the Ducatis. Their pace in race trim was pretty competitive, but of course, when you're starting down the grid, they couldn't overtake. So that's a big area that Yamaha are looking to improve this week.
Yeah, absolutely. We're going to talk about that in a little bit more detail in a moment. But for one final time, let's just get the thoughts of Jack Gorst live from the Sepang International Circuit. Jack, you've had the opportunity to speak with all of the key men associated with Yamaha ahead of this big 2024. What's the general consensus down there?
I think the general consensus might be kind of cautious optimism. It's always a little bit difficult to try with Yamaha because, of course, Lynn Jarvis is always kind of positive about the brand, but also does accept when they have work to do. As you've heard from him today, he said that they're not starting from zero, but that they're building up. It's a very, very important time in Yamaha's timeline right now. So, you know, we've seen, you can look at the bike itself here and we can see all the different parts. It's the most change we've seen on a Yamaha M1 in several years, probably for 10 years or something like that. So whether it's going to work or not, we'll have to wait and see. Of course, we do have 3 days on track now in Sepang to get a measure of that. And of course, the riders themselves said there that they feel optimistic as well, and that the feelings were good on the bike. Again, though, they're not screaming, yes, we're here and we've made a massive, massive step forward. I think we're going to have to wait and see with Yamaha, really. It's always a little bit tricky to tell with them. And I don't think it's any less tricky yet, but hopefully after 3 days on a track here, we'll have a bit more of a tell of where they're at.
Jack, thank you as ever. Great work. We appreciate your efforts and good luck throughout the next 3 days at the test. Looking forward to your work.
Thank you, buddy. Jack.
Yeah, very good. Nice to chat away with Jack Ghost, who, of course, you're going to be connecting live with from Sepang. Does know his stuff, does Jack? He's got a big old brain inside that head. Right, here's the question that we were asking you. I'm going to put it to you, Lewis, as well. Can Yamaha fight for the World Championship this year? What do you guys think? Yes or no? Not a surprising result, I don't think, that 81% of you feeling that no, it's going to be a step too far for them to be fighting for the World Championship this year. Very optimistic, glass half full, 19% of you. I like your outlook on life. Well done, guys. Lewis, for you, I said I don't think they can this year. I don't think winning races or being on the podium is out of the question, given the concessions that they've got, given the updates they can make throughout the year. But to fight for the World Championship, that's a step too far, do you think?
Yeah, my hunch is no, they can't. Jack Ghost alluded to the cautious optimism within Yamaha, and I think that's the kind of tone they have to sound. In terms of whether Yamaha can challenge for the championship, I don't think we should be expecting them to.
No.
It's a process, I think, for Yamaha to get back to where they want to be. I think Yamaha should realistically be hoping to try and challenge for victories, try and be a regular podium threat this year. I think that's a realistic expectation for them. We've already discussed the riding talent that they've got. There's no question that they have the riders to convert if the bike is good enough to fight at the front. So I think that's where Yamaha's expectations need to be. And of course, the concessions will hopefully help them try and close that gap. Of course, Ducati were able to benefit from concessions 10 or 12 years ago to bring themselves back towards the front. And Yamaha will be hoping they can follow a similar path. Although, as Ducati will be able to tell us, it didn't happen overnight for them either.
Yeah, absolutely. It does take time. It takes hard work. But it looks as though they've got the right minds there to hopefully be able to do it. I would ask you about the livery, but exactly the same. So
yeah, well, I fixed something that's not broken, I suppose. They did subtly change it last year, didn't they? They
went
for
the
sort of
camouflage
look, which I thought really worked. So I guess they decided there's no reason to change that after a year. It worked pretty well for me.
Let's talk, shall we, about the upcoming Sepang test. We've covered Yamaha a lot. We'll continue looking at those images there of the brand new bike for 2024 in case you guys haven't seen it just yet. Lots of storylines. We mentioned Ducati there. They were the real juggernauts of 2023. And their rider lineup has somehow managed to get even better this year as well. For the Sepang test, what are we going to be looking out for in particular down at Ducati? What do you think are going to be the key things for the guys at home to keep an eye on?
Well, they've promised new aero. They've promised sort of new aerodynamics around the bike, which we've had a sort of sneak peek of what that might resemble at the shakedown already. We might get a better idea over the course of the next 3 days. It's almost going to be a test of two halves for the 8 Ducati riders, because, of course, 4 of them are going to have 2024 bikes, the 2 factory riders and the 2 Pramac riders. Once, as I say, Frankie Morbidelli hopefully gets there and is declared fit. And as far as the Gresini riders and Petrosimir Enduro VR46, they will be on the bike that's just won the championship, the GP23. Yeah. So expect the GP23 riders to be particularly competitive early on, because, of course, they're riding a motorcycle that's already very much fettled, very much refined at the end of last season, because it won the final race last year.
Absolutely. Good to see Matt get involved again. Can't wait for After the Flag. Love MotoGP. Not going to let Jack shame me out of watching 2024. It's going to be awesome. Oh, I was only pulling your leg, Matt. Don't worry. Glad to have you on board once again. And yeah, I'm looking forward to After the Flag as well. Altav saying hopefully Yamaha will be better in the 2024 season than last season. Yeah, I'm sure there are a lot of people wearing blue that are hoping for the same thing as well. We touch on Ducati there. Nearest rivals this year going to be KTM, do we feel? I mean, they're financed so well. They've put so much effort behind it. Of course, another year now with that involvement with the Red Bull Formula One aerodynamics team to try and take them the next step forward. You feel as though this is a big, big year for KTM. They're not pumping all of the money into this MotoGP project to not win a race, which they didn't do last year. You feel as though they have to start showing some results this year. Otherwise, there's going to be some frustrated faces in the top hierarchy.
Well, KTM haven't won a dry weather full-length MotoGP Grand Prix since midway through 2021 at the Catalan Grand Prix. Their only wins in 22 were in the wet with Miguel Oliveira, and their only wins last year were sprints. So that's something that KTM have got to try and get on top of. It's notoriously difficult in pre-season testing to know what KTM are up to. We saw last year, we thought for so much of pre-season testing that KTM were in big trouble, but they were just working to a plan. They were working through all the different parts that they wanted to test out and then put that all together for the first Grand Prix of the season in Portimao for the full package. And it certainly worked, didn't it? Once we got to the first race of the season, Jack Miller was already setting all-time lap records in Friday practice. So don't necessarily get too concerned if KTM aren't up at the top of the timesheets in testing, but from what we've seen so far at the shakedown, particularly with Pedro Acosta, there's a fair chance they might be.
Yeah, a slight change in atmosphere, I would imagine, this time around at KTM. Things very different to 12 months ago, where it was all about revolution, a wildly different new engine, new aero, new chassis. There was huge changes going down there, and that's why it took them so long to piece all of those pieces of the puzzle together. This time around, I spoke with Francesco Guidotti a week or so ago, and he said it's all about evolution, finding those last little bits to be able to take the fight to Ducati. David has been getting in touch. Hi from France at Le Mans. Go Fabio. Yeah, unsurprisingly, plenty of Frenchmen out there, and French women as well, hoping to see strong stuff from Fabio Quartararo and Johann Zarco this year. Camshaft thinking that Rins's victory may well come at the Saxon Ring. Well, Camshaft, I admire your optimism there, but Marc Marquez on a Ducati? Surely no one's going to get near him at the Saxon Ring.
You wouldn't have thought so. Marc Marquez, I think, will be highly motivated to try and put that one right. He probably reached his ultimate low at Repsol Honda last year at the Saxon Ring, so Marc Marquez will be keen to put that right. But I think Alex Rins is a fair shout to take victories this season. As I say, if Yamaha are competitive enough, we've seen enough from Alex Rins to know that he's good enough to convert that. As we discussed earlier on, fitness is a real question mark, I suppose, for Alex Rins, but given the mileage he's already done at the shakedown test so far, there haven't appeared to be any ill effects, and he certainly didn't suggest that there are any ill effects there in the interview he gave with Jack. So from Alex Rins' point of view, you would expect the adaptation to be fairly seamless. So he's only on the Honda for a year, and of course he's been riding motorcycles that you'd expect to behave quite similar to the Yamaha he's jumping on in the past with the Suzuki for so many years. I guess he'll be hoping, much like Fabio Quartararo will be, that the Yamaha behaves a little bit better than it did last year, because of course they tried to find more power last year, more top-end speed. They found it, but they found it at the sacrifice of Yamaha's great strength over so many years, which was turning instability.
Yeah, absolutely. And that was a key point that Cal Crutchlow, whenever he was on site in Japan in particular, I remember where he was speaking to the media. Well, I think he could have sat down and done 6 hours with us. And then in Valencia, I was able to catch up with him as well. And that was his key thing that he's been pushing to try and get the guys to understand that although the speed sheets, the time sheets might look a little bit better, that doesn't necessarily translate into lap time. This one from Eliud. No, Ducati will take it as Marc Marquez is with the right bike, as we all know his performance is mental. Yeah, difficult to disagree with that. You would have to feel that Mark is going to be a key contender this year. Just to continue our chat on some of the key things to look out for and after the flag at the Sepang test, Aprilia is going to be again a big year for them. I think at the end of last year they held their hands up and potentially felt as if they maybe bit off more than they could chew with the addition of the independent squad. Now that Miguel Oliveira is going to have the full factory RSGP alongside Aleix Espargaró and Maverick Viñales, you feel as though that they're in a strong position to maybe have that consistency, which he didn't have last year. Aprilia was the bike last year. When it was good, it was absolutely fantastic. When it was bad, it was an absolute disaster. They didn't have that middle ground at all.
And I think Aprilia left points on the table last season. There were some key errors that they made at various stages, perhaps choosing wrong tyres, particularly cast your mind back to Indonesia when Aleix Espargaró looked to have the performance to win that Grand Prix. Went for the soft rear tyre and just plummeted down the order in the second half of that race. I guess a big, obvious shortcoming for Aprilia last year was their starts. Maverick Viñales in particular struggled with the starts. He did speak in the latter stages of last year saying that he hopes for a magic clutch for Aprilia coming to this season, because that was one area that they were quite literally left standing against their opposition. They were slow off the line. No matter how well they qualified, Viñales and Espargaró couldn't necessarily convert that in the race because they were slow off the line. So that will be one key area that they'll be looking to improve upon. So don't be surprised if you see quite a lot of Maverick Viñales in pit lane doing practice starts over the next 3 days.
Yeah, that is, if you've got your bingo card at home, that is one of them for the tests and after the flag. See Maverick Viñales doing practice starts. I think one of them as well is him ending fastest. He is the testing world champion after all. This one comes in for you, Lewis, from De Banza. Not a question for Quartararo fans or anyone, but what do you think in general Rins will be able to do on the Yamaha? Will he be close to the Frenchman?
Close to him, yes. Whether he'll be ahead of him, I'm not so sure. Fabio Quartararo is so phenomenally talented and has spent his whole career on a Yamaha, so I think to expect Alex Rins to go straight into that team and beat him immediately, I think is too much to ask. But as we've discussed already, we know how talented Alex Rins, is if the Yamaha behaves more like the Yamaha we've been used to speaking about prior to last year, you'd imagine that will suit Alex Rins' style. And we've seen in various circuits over the years that Alex Rins is phenomenal. Silverstone, he goes very well. Austin, he goes very well, as he's proven twice in the past. The only rider to beat Marc Marquez on a Honda at that circuit, of course, winning there last year. So I think Alex Rins will be there or thereabouts, but I wouldn't expect too much too soon from Alex Rins. It will be a learning process for him. So expect as the year goes on, Alex Rins to get stronger and stronger. But I think as the year goes on, he'll close in on Fabio. But I think Fabio will certainly start the year ahead of him.
And for his teammate as well, Fabio Quartararo, as was mentioned in the team launch, and I'm sure there's going to be lots of questions as we go throughout the year as well. He's a free agent at the end of the year, and one of the most high-profile free agents at the end of the year. He hasn't been scared to let Yamaha management know that if this bike this year doesn't provide me the opportunity to be competitive, I will look elsewhere. And I'm sure that has pricked up the ears of quite a few team managers in wearing different colours.
And we generally see those decisions made fairly early, don't we? So in some ways, that might be the most important element of this Sepang test for Yamaha, is Fabio Quartararo will want to see clear signs of improvement. I don't think Fabio Quartararo, as much as in his heart of hearts he'd want to see the silver bullet and to see Yamaha back up at the front again, I don't think in his heart of hearts he'll be expecting that. He'll want to see clear signs of progress, not just only with the competitiveness of the motorcycle, but also the working methods within Yamaha. We did hear Lynn Jarvis sort of allude to that they are sort of updating, if you like, their methods and trying to be much more like the European manufacturers, which of course have dominated MotoGP, particularly over the last 18 months. So I think Fabio Quartararo, if he sees signs of progress and sees signs that Yamaha are going to get back towards their old form again, he might be convinced to stay. But certainly with the talent that Fabio Quartararo has and seeing the competitiveness of Ducati, you do wonder if Yamaha don't make that progress, how quickly that patience runs out.
Yeah, and where he may well end up if he is to move on from Yamaha as well. Aprilia, potentially? Honda? Ducati? Who knows? Lewis, just before we say goodbye, the floor is yours. 30 seconds after the flag coming up tomorrow. Why should people tune in?
Well, you'll have all the best reaction and analysis from the Sepang test. So we're on air 30 minutes before the checkered flag comes out. So adjust that accordingly as to whatever time that will be where you're watching in the world. Myself and Elliot York will be analysing everything that goes on in Sepang. We'll be crossing over live as well to hear from Simon Crafer and Jack Gorst, who are on the ground in Malaysia. And we'll also be bringing you live reaction from the circuit from the very best riders in MotoGP, as well as bringing you various features that have been filmed on the ground in Sepang. So we'll be hearing from some of the key team personnel as well. So 30 minutes before the checkered flag, we'll be live, and we'll continue for an hour after the session finishes on all 3 days of the Sepang test.
Perfect. I'll be there. I'm looking forward to it. Lewis, thank you for your time. Good luck tomorrow.
Pleasure.
And looking forward to watching after the flag. Right, if you want, you can jump outside the screen now. I'll let you go and crack on with your notes. Of course, the studio is actually, if we did be able to turn the camera, it's just over there is the studio where we're going to see after the flag be coming to you live tomorrow. As Louis said, half an hour before the checkered flag comes out, which is 5:30 local time in Malaysia, 10:30 here in Central Europe, 9:30 in the UK. So make sure that you set your alarms, make sure you watch it for the best analysis and insight of everything that's happened in Malaysia. Right, just before we leave you, let's remind you of what is to come over the next week or so. Our focus now will switch, of course, to the Sepang test and after the flag, which kicks off tomorrow, the 6th, the 7th, the 8th of July. Little bit of a break then, we'll have the weekend off, and then look at that. That is a monster of a week for team presentations as we tick another four off on Monday. This time next week, time for the Red Bull KTM Factory Racing launch, where we'll be hearing live from Jack Miller and Brad Binder. 24 hours on from that, it's time for the Repsol Honda boys to officially get their campaign underway. Then it's LCR Honda, and then on Sunday we'll be live at the LaSalle International Circuit in Qatar for Aprilia's launch. And then it's time for the Qatar test, and then it's time for Prima Pramac Racing to finish off presentation season, which then means it's time to go racing. But for the moment, we'll put that one in the locker. We'll save that for a couple of weeks' time, because right now it's time to go testing. Yamaha are officially underway. Fabio Quartararo and Alex Rins, a brand new lineup for them. What can they do this year? A lot of optimism there. Maybe we'll see them up at the top fighting for the world championship again. Excitement levels are at an all-time high, because tomorrow it's time for the Premier Class grid to officially kick off 2024. Thanks for your company this morning. Make sure you tune in to After the Flag tomorrow. 2024 officially starts in less than 24 hours' time. Can't wait.